I became a peddler. I started selling pan, even in the streets of Nairobi. Pastor would come and sometimes with a Sheng language to Namonga Pase, after seeing my father to struggle better to let us attack. To us, we were thinking that these pastors are just after our money.
Hello and welcome to the Conquerors Show. I'm your host today, Eva Maguti, and we hope that our stories and testimonies keep inspiring you each and every day and giving you hope as we keep on encouraging you to trust in God and to trust on what your purpose is here on earth. And today I am joined by a very, very good guest. His name is Pastor James, and he's going to explain to us and tell us his story and how he has conquered and everything to know about him. Karibu sana, Pastor James.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, you can introduce yourself.
My name is Pastor James Njuguna. I'm born again, I'm saved. I love Jesus Christ as my personal savior. And today I'm so happy, all the viewers, or wherever that you're watching us, happy to share my story. I believe it will also encourage somebody because the Lord has taken me from afar and a long journey so far I thank the Lord. So I want to welcome everybody first as we share our story and even my testimony. God bless you.
We are so glad to have you here today. Mm-hmm. And just to go straight to your story, mm-hmm. tell us who is Pastor James and where you're from and what you do.
Yeah, Pastor James currently is a minister of the gospel. I serve the Lord with a church called Christ the Way of Life Center. We are located in Embakasi, Tasia. Mm-hmm. But I've come from afar. I was born and raised in one of the slums here in Nairobi, known as Korokocho. Somewhere in Kariobangi. It's a tough place to be born and also to be raised in. But the Lord has been faithful from that slum to what I am today. I thank the Lord and I glorify God. And most of my story and my testimony, I give it from where I was born, how I was raised, to where I am today, so that I can encourage and remind somebody, no matter where you come from, no matter where you are raised or born from, you can still become a person by the will of God.
Amen, amen. Yeah. It's really good to know that God can lift someone up despite their background. And majorly, your background being a major part of your story, we would like to know, like, where did you start? Like, as you were born in Korokocho, from school to how you transition now to being the man that you are right now.
Yeah.
Yes, tell us about that.
Going to school was not easy. Mm-hmm. In fact, I thank the Lord. This is by the grace of God, because the poverty level that we witness in the slum and in the ghetto. And in fact, I had to drop school at primary school. I did not make past primary school, but the grace of God has carried me through. Reason being, we were born in one of the very poorest slums. You have to fend for yourself when you are young. Both of our parents were so poor they could have not even afford basic needs. Leave alone paying school fees, because back then the school was not free. But by the grace of God, as I grew up in the slum, okay, life in slum was not easy,
mm-hmm.
because you're pushing to poverty, you also find yourself maybe into criminal gangs, to find yourself an alcoholic, addicted to a lot of things. So that was the reason why, first and foremost, I did not go past primary school, because of poverty levels that were there. I had to fend for myself, because we were five of us. We were born five kids.
Okay.
I was the second born.
Mm-hmm.
And our parents were unable even to feed us. So as I was growing up in the slum, like any other young man in slum, I find myself joining some criminal groups, joining bad companies.
Mm-hmm.
And while I was there joining bad companies, back then in the 80s and 90s, but by the grace of God, there is a man of God who used to come and preach the gospel in our area. His name is Titus Wanjao. He's still alive today. He's my spiritual father. And I thank God for that man that God used to come and preach the gospel to us. I remember while he was preaching the gospel to us, it was not even one time. He would come again and again, but we were kind of rotten. We could have not even listened to him. Sometimes he would come and we attack him. But when God has a purpose with your life, when God is calling you, the man that is sent, one thing that I'm happy about him, he came again and again. He never gave up, came and preached to us again and again. And by the grace of God, early 1999, the end of 1999, I surrendered my life to Jesus, and my journey of Christianity and serving the Lord started there.
Ah, that's amazing. Now, just to take you back, you say that you were, in one way or another, influenced to joining the Bad Company.
Yeah.
Uleza kujipata aje hapo? How was it like being recruited?
Yeah.
And what things were you guys doing?
You know, in Islam, if I may give my testimony, I was as young as 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
And as young as 10 years in Islam, there is a language that we use in Islam, and it's called kuchemba. So kuchemba.
It's
currently the one that they used to be. But back then,
kuchemba
we used to
call it floating here. Yeah.
Kuchemba, it's like you become a chokora.
Okay.
You have to go on the streets. You have to go, maybe, for example, where there are dustbins, to go places where they throw trashes, look for containers, for scrap metals, for papers to sell.
Mm.
Now, between the age of 10 and 12, life was so tough that sometimes I'll not even sleep home because we've gone out there. For example, we used to come from Korokocho to a place called Buruburu. You go from Korokocho, Kariobangi South, outer ring to Buruburu. And sometime when you go there, coming back home, you fear the punishment that mama will give you. So because, though mom was poor, whether we were poor, it was not the wish of any parent that you become a chokora. So while I was there, I'll go and sometime so you find yourself, you are out of home, you are sleeping out. And I remember there's a place that we used to sleep. It was a place, a woman that was selling vegetables. We call them Mama Mboga. So we'll wait for this Mama Mboga to close down her business, and then we'll sleep there. So that's how, as a young person, you grow up with others. Others are older than you. They are more experienced to that than you. Now, when you are between 10 and 12, you don't know much.
But that time you had dropped out
primary school.
Okay.
Like class 4 or 5 there.
Mm.
I dropped out of primary school. I never reached class 6. And when we started that life, you know, now you keep on learning more, kind of maturing, growing, and you're exposed to a lot of things. So you're exposed to a lot of things too much too early. Sometimes you'll go that what I was calling kuchemba, and maybe there's no food. You'll go through trashes, nothing there. And you are forced to take whatever that you find. For instance, in Buruburu, we used to go, you find even a pair of shoes out. You start small like that before you become a criminal gang. And you know,
unaanza chini, unaanza na levels, okay.
And somehow, for you to survive that life, kind of that life requires you to be hardcore. So there's what you are recruited to do, but there is also what you are learning, what you are developing in you. You know, sometimes you go to places like, for example, you come from this poor family, grow up in the background. You go there, maybe you see people who are making out, who are making well in life. You kind of feel like if you can take anything that they have. So it's not just being recruited. In slums, this thing develops naturally in you.
Because you hate the condition that you're in
right now.
Uh-huh.
And when you see people who have made it in life, you think it is their fault. That's why you suffer. So that's how I find myself there. And slowly, we formed a group. You know, where you started 3, 4, 5, but because of poverty, other kids will follow you. Maybe they'll see you've gone to Buru, you've gone to Kariobangi South, you've come with a new pair of shoes. It's like you are doing well than them. If not even shoes, you have gone, you have come with those leftovers, your food, my chickens, my whatever, my chips, come with them with a paper bag. So they kind of start enjoying you. They see you are 13, 14, and you're not sleeping at your mom's place. You are out there fending for yourself. They also suffer the same problem that you go through. So they join you slowly. So finally, we joined a group, or rather, a group formed. We used to call ourselves Kandish.
Kamjesh.
Yes.
That is Kamjeshi.
Yeah.
Kamjeshi.
And it grew up to maybe we were like up to 20, 25 people.
Oh.
And now from there, you know, when one, everybody comes from different backgrounds.
Yeah.
Some are tougher than you, some are cruel than you. And that group went to a point where by now it was not just a group of what we call Chokorao street boys. It turned to be somewhat drug peddlers.
It's like a gang now.
Yes, uh-huh. Like some of them will sell the glue. I became a peddler, started selling pan, even in the streets of Nairobi. But by the grace of God, still, every time that we go back in our slum, that man of God used to come, especially used to come in our area. Okay, there's a place that we call Bez. Bez is whereby.
See, when I end up to chill.
And pastor would come and sometime with a Sheng language to Namambia Pase, Afia Cinema Fala to struggle better to let us attack. Acho Jinga, Chachina Dagatome, Danganyo, Poenda, Namambia Nini. And the man of God never get tired of preaching the gospel to us. And I remember one day he came and while we were telling him, we are not fools, we are not stupid, we cannot go to church. Church is for fools, we cannot struggle and hustle in the ghetto and take money to him. Because to us, we were thinking that these pastors are just after our money. And a lot of my friends, sad to say, they were killed. Because back then, I remember, it was the Moy era. It's when Flying School was formed to deal with, especially the slums boys. Because 80% of criminal operations are planned in the streets. So most of my friends died. Some of them were shot dead. Some of them were beaten up by mob. We call it mob justice.
Oh, maybe I'm too.
Yes.
Wana kunini.
Because I've told you, tunatoka coach, tunaenda
buu.
And if we'll find nothing to eat, that evening we'll make sure kuna lugha tulikuwa tunatumia. Uwezi lala njaa mafala watu wa mtaani. Afadhali mzaya pige nduru mimi mkule.
Okay.
So you see, because there is nothing to it, anything that you find, even if it's an old man, whoever there. And now, like criminal groups, other criminal groups that are more advanced, you know, say more advanced is meaning that there are some criminal groups that are advanced. That you will find you are young, come from slum, is when you are maturing. But those who have advanced ahead of you, they want to use you. For example, if they want to traffic or peddle anything illegal, they'll come to our group and we'll be like, Jemo beba ikitu, kutane burume sora, kapatia daundili. And so come to know what you're given to carry. Maybe it's drug, maybe it's a weapon, an illegal weapon, maybe. And you know, slowly, slowly, we mature, we grow until we find ourselves at a point whereby some of our parents wish that we were dead. Because it became a disgrace to them. Every time that a theft or either a criminal happenings will happen within Eastland, we call it Eastland, some of the policemen will come even to our homes because we reach a point whereby we are in the most wanted list of the police.
Wow.
So, but I thank God, still, my mom, okay, a little bit, my mom, I believe, and that's why even to date, I encourage parents to be prayerful parents. Because though my mom was poor, she was a very unique woman. Raising us in the slum, she never joined other, okay, the normal business in slum, 80 to 90% of our slums, ladies will sell chinga, the liquid chinga brewers. But my mama, she never did that. She was going that what I was calling kuchem.
Like,
she also was collecting, or either going through Dandora, Uruma, and all the places collecting waste materials, scrap metals. That's how she tried to feed us with. But she was a very prayerful woman. And I believe partly also Mama used to pray for me. Because at a time we'll go a group of four or five, and three will never come home. Three will be shot dead that evening. One will be running, maybe two are shot. I remember there was a time, okay, say that there's a place called Kiambi. So from Buruburu, when, for example, the police will put an ambush, you are running from Buruburu and you have to run to a ghetto called Kembi, is down Buruburu there. So there was an incident whereby we were like five of us, and two were shot dead. And one ran to Kiambu, and the mob justice dealt with the man. But by the grace of God, we happened to go. I mean, when we ran, we never ran to Kiambu. Back then, there was this place, Kagundo Road, there is an area known KCC. Mm-hmm. It was a bush, kind of a bush. From Caltex Umoja, all the way to KCC, to a place called Andora, this one, it was bushes. So by the grace of God, we maneuvered those bushes. And we get to our ghetto. Now, from the Dora Phase 1, there's a dam site called Muku. When life became tough, the police started killing some of us.
Mm.
And as I saw, most of my peers died, most of my colleagues. So we changed. We joined the Mukuru group. Now, Mukuru is a place whereby it's the dam site where all the garbage of Nairobi is done. So the garbage we use now to become the Mukuru people. Now, Mukuru people, still life was hard there.
Mm.
Because when you go there, you have to join also. Okay, for you to survive in that dump site, you should also join a group. So we have to have gang or group members. One is going to be Bezia Machizi, Mapielo, and the other one to look at my Jita Bezia Waze. So depending on how strong is your group, or either your gang member, you will survive. So kind of we changed the tactics because we saw most of us dying. So by the grace of God also, we joined the Mukuru. We become like, okay, we use now we are not going to Buruburu everywhere. We are waiting for those lorries to come with cabbage. You will select what can be sold, what can be eaten, because whatever that they bring, you'll select the scrap metals, the waste papers, food to eat, and some foods will sell for not only one of Gamangruem time.
So
they'll come for that. They are mama pika samaki, those people ambao na pikanga mandazi mtaani, they'll come for firewoods. So once a lorry bring the garbage, you put everything aside. Those plastic containers, those are firewoods, those are papers, and you also find something to it. There was a lorry that was coming from the airport, what made it a Chombo. Now, Chombo was a lorry that would carry all the waste from the airplanes. This one made us even to kill and fight.
Wow, hold it right there.
Yeah.
We are going to take a short commercial break and we will be right back with Pastor James explaining to us how he transitioned from being in the slums and to where he is right now. Don't go anywhere.
There are people who are actually struggling, you know, so they want to prove that they are okay qua social media. So many people on social media, they live for the comments.
Yeah.
You know, they live for the likes. Use social media, ikusaidie. There are so many people who talk about relationships on social media that can help you. Vitu zinaweza kujenga. Becoming a better version of yourself. You become a better person for yourself and also for your partner. You know, it all starts with yourself before it goes to your partner.
Welcome back to the Conquerors Show. We are so excited that you're still here with us. We are diving deep into the story of Pastor James, and he is telling us on how he was living and he was born in the slums and how he transitioned to where he is right now. Nataka tuendele. Uliko umefika kwa ile lori mlikuwa mnaita Chombo.
Yeah.
Tell us about that.
Now, when we were there, a place known as Mukuru is the main dump site of every garbage that is collected in Nairobi.
Mm.
This lorry called Chombo, because it has precious things, because the garbage that comes from the aeroplanes, some of them are international garbages, like you say. Chakula za wazungu, you find something from abroad, za inje. This one called Chombo, it makes us even to continue recruiting our group to become strong. It's reached a point whereby even some of our members had to have even guns. Because now for this lorry,
wow,
it was lorry that came with precious things. By the way, Sometimes you use even to have, as you do what I was calling chamber, you'll have even a gold there. You'll have things that are so
mtu alipoteza kakitu.
Things that are precious and expensive. Mm. So it poses that if it reaches a point whereby, okay, at first we used to do what we call katamlima dembo. Now katamlima dembo is how your group is strong.
Uh-huh.
So when the role is pouring, you'll kind of reach a point whereby you take up to this place is mine and up to
the other place.
But it reached a point because of chaos and bloodshed and murder, we changed the method and it was to be taken by shifts. Like for example, our team, the Ziamachizi. Ours was Monday. You'll find maybe Monday and Friday. You know that role when it comes, Monday and Friday.
Yeah.
The Ziyama PLO will be Tuesday and Wednesday. The Ziyawazai, maybe one day per week. But they were called Wazai because most of them, they were older. They were more stronger than us. They could have not fight like they used to.
Mm.
Now, when we were there, there is there are brothers who got saved. Some of them ahead of us. And thank God, there is a bishop called Bishop Karens.
Wow.
He has a church called Destiny Worship Center.
Okay.
He's in Dandora.
Wow.
When we were there, some of the people still collecting garbages, but they gave their life to Jesus.
Being in the gangs.
Being there because of the life. But now we were being encouraged. Like, kama Karens anaweza sevika.
Hata wewe.
Na shike. Hata mimi naweza. Kama fulani anaweza. Now, by the grace of God, in Dandora, near Damset, there is a ground used to be called near.
Mm-hmm.
Crusades used to come there. And sometime we'll get out of Damset and go just to listen for fun, not because we want to be saved. But there, when the altar call will be called, we'll see some of my friends go and then be actually jinga. Hata unasevika hiku kwa ni ya mafala. Kwa unasitwago geto lagu pelekeka pasta sadaka. So, slowly, from that crusade to the prayers of my mom, you remember I said she was a prayerful woman, to another servant of God who used to preach now in Islam, used to live with us, used to do the open air, the crusades, those door-to-door evangelism.
Mm-hmm.
So, keep on reaching us. I'll come back, though, before I got saved.
Mm-hmm.
I met now my wife, but she was my girlfriend. And she got, we started life, not really marrying each other.
Mm-hmm.
It's poverty and hardship of slum that brought us together.
Mm-hmm.
Remember I told you, we used to go to Buru, come with things. She was also coming from a poor family. So she know a good boy and a kutangana mavitu. So she came because of mavitu.
Yeah.
And by the grace of God, that's how I know God planned it and purposed it.
Mm-hmm.
So when we started life with her, she got saved.
Oh, before you now?
Before me.
Okay.
And she was in salvation for 3 years. While still me, I'm kind of, when she got saved, it's kind of because sasa, I remember, when you live in slum, there are things that you do. There are others that you do to hide what you are doing. You'll be doing what I was calling to chamber, but chambering is kind of hiding the other life that you do.
Mm.
For example, in most of those areas, you'll find people collecting waste papers or either, we call it scrap metals. But that base of scrap metal, many other things that are done there, so we used to hide ourselves
through
scrap metal. When she got saved ahead of me, she used to pray for me because she knew that this is the life that I used to live.
It's dangerous.
It's dangerous. Na funny enough, early okoka zile kanisa za kitamba za watu za my mind.
Oh.
And she was made a prophet there.
Alipewa cheo.
There was sharia katika hiyo church.
Mm.
You have to prophesy on Sunday. You must start praying and fasting Thursday, Friday, Saturday. So that on Sunday when you come,
the spirit of the Lord.
There, your spirit is not.
Mm. It's not wrong.
They used to call it with our language, but to help you, Mr. Gima. Don't prophesying what you have eaten here. We live what the Spirit of the Lord says.
Okay.
So sometimes I'll come with my bang, and especially I used to be a peddler.
Mm.
I'll smoke a bang in the same room that she's in while she prayed on Thursday, Friday, Saturday.
Yeah.
Later on, through her pastor, they used to come to my house.
Mm.
At the time I'll come, nimetoka na huko maasozangu, na kutu wameleta fellowship, wameja kwa kanyumba kando, walistaka ghetto room, nyumba kadogo. And I'll wait watu wa church waende. And I'll get in and tamfuruga, leta mambo. Izo ujinga zenu za church na makofi mingi huku kutuletea swara, nisiwe kutawa mapasta wenu kutena. But later on, one day she invited me. This is how I give. Now I want to give my testimony on how I came to be saved.
Uh-huh.
There was a kesha in their church. And she invited me to join a kesha. So we planned. She told me ahead of time. She told me it was like on Wednesday. And she told me on Friday to go on a kesha.
Mm.
So we want to welcome. She welcomed me. I agree.
Sour.
And on Friday, I came home, it was around 8 p.m. Kapataki pika, she reminded me kuna kesha. And we started arguing. And my language was, oh, no, na mina kakama umbwa mwitu katikati ya makondo, na miambia nini, zo jinga zenu. And we argued from like 8 p.m. to almost 11. Now, she knew, nikiwa na eyo geto, hakuna mtu aneza mhanda. So we were to go with her. Okay, she told me, give me a push, like his indication, from where we are to where the church was. While we were going, we meet other brethren, other people from that church. And they told me, oh, and you're going to Jemima. So could you to Salimia? And I went and greet them. One of them that I'll never forget, my little brother Njoro, still there, may the Lord bless brother Njoro. He told me, Sungefika tu, uendo wone mlango ya church. Kule waifu wako wanashiriki. Ukiona tu mlango ya church wa urudi. Because they knew me.
Alijua. Oh, walikuwa wanakujua.
Mtu anaweza ingia church.
Mm.
So, like, preaching to me, Yesu anakupenda, nini, unaweza samehewa, hizo nilikuwa walikuwa wamenihubiria wamechoka.
Mm.
Through that, Pastor Titus Wanjabu.
Mm.
So, when I went there, Njoro told me, hii ndio church ya waifu wako wanaendanga. So, ungeingia tu ukaliekiti ya church tu, alafu
Mbelezo ile ya kuku na mahindi. Kamoja.
Kaliade the kiti ya church. Mm. And I remember that day, kuna lugha tulikuwa tunatumia mtaa inaitwa kusani. Sani is when you buy a bank,
okay,
roll
okay,
like a stone, you go, you okay, is the way you used to do it. So nilikuwa nimeacha nimesani, nimeacha kwa hao.
Squeezy ni bags.
Yeah. That's how. From that kesha, around now, it was around 3 a.m. in the morning,
mm-hmm.
the pastor called an altar call, and I find myself there,
wow.
And I gave my life to Jesus.
Wow, that's amazing.
When I gave my life to Jesus, now the pastor knew me, and he knew the story that I gave you there, the kind of members that we have. He started using me to reach other young people back then. Because it was in 90s.
Mm.
He wanted now, when we do an open air, I'll be there. When there's something, I'll be there. So he used kind of, okay, my jama will come, my peer groups will come. Kama jimona ya mesevika. Sisi tunaweza. And because they used to know me, some of them, they used even to fear me. Because
ulikuwa ushafika.
Unapita base, watu wanasema, tulia za huyo boy ni mbaya. And so they used to, aliokoka. Really? And so they used to come.
Mm.
So the man of God mentored me and he started, okay, we started through open airs.
Mm.
He'll give me maybe 10 minutes to speak.
Yeah.
And that's how slowly, I grew up in the things of God.
Yeah.
Wow. Until I received the call now to become a servant of God.
Okay.
When I gave my life to Jesus, I thank God, there was a fellowship of other brethren that used to fellowship with them. They were not from our church. They were from KH New Matari.
Mm-hmm.
I thank God for them. And most of them were ladies.
Okay.
Through them, as they started, there was a woman who came in our area. She was a Tanzanian. But she was selling zogu githeri, chapati, tule tuotelitutu wa mta.
Mm.
And when she heard that I gave my life to Jesus, and Brother Njoro was very alcoholic. So she used to give us a tayogi there, because now you have given your life to Jesus. Life is tough. You don't have even something. You used to kumezwa ile like ya ndiukule lazima ufanye kitu mbaya. Now you have given your life to Jesus. The church that you have joined, almost the same people, same life, because it is in Islam. So no one can help each other. And you see, you remember I told you, even some of the brothers and sisters that we had in Mukuru now, the dump site, they were saved. Okay. So we live the same life.
Yeah.
But by the grace of God, we started doing a fellowship with those sisters.
Yeah.
And one of them called me. She was a supervisor in a certain company. That company is in the airport. They supply vegetables, fruits, and flowers. And I was connected to go there. Now, by the grace of God, now I'm preaching the gospel. Life is tough. But I think God opened a way for me. I went there as a cleaner. I went into that company as a cleaner. But as I was resigning that company, I was a supervisor.
Wow.
So I was promoted into a hygiene department. Something that is very funny, or either I don't say, I can say God is amazing. I used to supervise graduates. Yet I told you that I dropped in
at 10 years.
How I became a supervisor, it was also by the grace of God.
Eh.
When I was there, there was this, okay, in those companies whereby they export vegetable flowers and food, hygiene is of high standard.
Yeah, yeah.
So one of the bosses there, she was a woman. 3 months to 4 months, she spotted me. You know, the zeal, the passion, being born and raised from the slum, and now you have gotten a job. You can get into a staff bus. You go there, you work. Then you work hard. And now I was saved. So I'm transformed. She could have seen this a different guy. She gave me she called me after 3 to 4 months. She told me, she never told me I'm making you a supervisor. She told me, nataka unaniangalilia watu, au unaniletea report. So the hygiene department that we were 25 people, and we'll do the cleaning in the morning and in the evening. Now there's this night shift and there is day shift. So our work was to wait when night shift are cleared, we do the cleaning. When day shift cleared, we do the cleaning. So I become the supervisor of the hygiene department. And from the grace of God, I grew there. Now my life came from Korokocho to Dandora. It's a place known as Dandora. So this time, Mungu ameanza kufungua milango. Unapata kamshahara. You are able to pay even a single room. 1500, 1800. And from Dandora, I find myself now in Mbakasi. While I was working as a supervisor, still there was this call to serve God. It was heavy on me. I worked there for 14 years by the grace of God. But 7 years of that, the first 7 years, there was no problem. But the second 7 years was hard on me because the call of God was tough on me to serve the Lord. Now my kids were growing up. They are in school. And I feel like it's a job hard. God, are you serious? Like you're calling me to quit employment. But by the grace of God, I was in a church in Dandora. But by the grace of God, there was that call to start another branch in Mbakasi.
Okay.
And by the grace of God, I started a branch while working in that company and still serving the Lord in Mbakasi. So we started small, and so far we thank the Lord. We have reached many. So I would like to encourage anybody.
Yeah.
Who have gone like my life, or either who are born and raised in one of the slums in the world. It's not the end. And God is marvelous.
Yes,
God
is awesome. Yes.
Concluding, like 2 or 3 days I've been sharing the book of Luke, chapter 10, verses 46, about the blind man that marched. The Bible says that when he heard that it was Jesus that was passing, he kept on shouting, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. But the Bible says many silenced the guy. Now that's Luke chapter 10 from 46 going down. Many told Bartimaeus, shut up, you blind man. But the Bible says the more they told the man, shut up, the more he shouted out. So the message that I had to people, in Swahili I'll say, kata kunyamazisho, like blind man, Bartimaeus.
Yeah.
A good example of Bartimaeus, they were telling you are good for nothing. You are a liability. You don't add any value to the society.
Mm-hmm.
But the Bible says when Jesus heard Bartimaeus, he stood and he said, call the guy. To me, I relate with that story of Bartimaeus.
Mm-hmm.
Because we came from slum whereby we think we are good for nothing. We add no value to the society.
Mm-hmm.
We are a liability. In fact, it reached a point whereby our parents used to regret because we turned to be what they never expected us to become.
Yeah.
But I thank God, like Bartimaeus, when you call on Jesus, can still stand for you.
Yes.
Or that can stand because of you.
Mm-hmm.
So the Bible says he called Bartimaeus and he asked the man, what do you want me to do for you?
Mm-hmm.
And Bartimaeus said, I would like to see. Sharing that message, I would say, I never saw what I am today until I met Jesus. Because when Bartimaeus met Jesus, his request was, okay, he could have said, I want an apartment, I want Range Rover, I want to see. So I've been looking what I've become. I never saw it then. When those preachers were preaching to us, I never see myself becoming a supervisor. I never see myself becoming a servant of God and a preacher of the gospel. I never see myself where I am today. Also, something happened. When I got saved, my firstborn was 3 years.
Okay.
His name is Peter. And I started praying. I started saying, Lord, help my son not to be what I was. Like, nimeishi ghetto, nimeokota, nimekimbizwa na makarao. I was this guy, ukiona mtu nakakoti mtaani unahama. Because, you know, you think ni CID wamekuja kutafuta.
Uh-huh.
Nowadays wanaitwa ma DCI. Hiyo wakati si kwa tunaitwa mafebi. So, because of that life, even kuwepa makarao, we were not living in one place. Sometimes you live in Milky, the other time you are in Kiambu, the other time you are somewhere. So I grew up in the life that I started, even I myself, I hate that kind of life. And I prayed to God when my firstborn was 3 years. And my prayer was, God, help this to my son not to become what I became. And I thank God. Two of my sons, as we're speaking, they have cleared high school.
Okay, wow.
One of them has already cleared college.
Mm-hmm.
He's now doing his businesses.
Mm-hmm.
And thank God for all of them.
Mm-hmm.
I have a daughter. She's there. And I tell you, she's in class 8, don't know primary.
Mm-hmm.
And juzi tukaona tutafuta kengine kakutoa viatu chini ya kitanda. And I told Manu.
When I tango a retirement.
So I'm a father of four, and I still serve the Lord.
Mm.
And sometimes you find me preaching on the streets.
Yes.
Okay, another thing that the Lord has given me for like 6 years even, when we go to conferences, is a man. I talk to men.
Mm.
In fact, on Friday, we are going to men's kesha.
Mm.
I talk to men. I do conferences. I do seminars. Mostly men and youth.
Okay.
I talk to men and youth.
Mm.
In conferences, in seminars, and do that.
Mm. Ah, that's amazing. Mm. We are so excited that you're able to share your story with us and how you transitioned from being in the slums and where you are today.
Mm.
We thank God and we are hoping that you've been able to give someone hope. And as we finish, you can give your parting shot, then we can conclude.
Amen.
Mm.
My parting shot will be still in the book of Luke chapter 10. And I'll talk to somebody and I tell her, though you look useless and valueless today, maybe you look like a liability. See the life of Bartimaeus, a man that used to be, you know, the Bible says he was a blind man and a beggar. Okay, I give an example of 3 blind men. Okay, let me just use that. Okay, they call them visually
impaired.
Impaired.
Mm-hmm.
There's Reuben Kigame, he's a blind man but not a beggar.
Mm.
In fact, he went to buy for the president of this nation. There's a man called Henry Wanyoike. He was a marathoner. a blind but not a beggar. There's the no, we all know the no. It's a gospel musician, a blind man but not a beggar. But Bartimaeus was a blind man and a beggar. My parting shot will be, if Christ can stand because of Bartimaeus, he can still stand for you also. And my encouragement is, kata kunyamazishwa. Yeah, today you might not see what you'll become, or rather what God is planning for you to become.
Mm-hmm.
But like Bartimaeus, keep on shouting, keep on calling on Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Because some of us and most of my friends, like where I am today, I cannot associate my achievement with anything else. But because of Jesus, Jesus made all the difference. So my last but not least word, I'll encourage anybody that is there and is not born again. If you have never surrendered your life to Jesus, maybe when you say wageto, umelelewa iriambaya, kazi yako ni kulajaba, unapiga mangwai. Yani wewe ni, ile inasemekana ngambaka makara wakwenu, they know you by your name. But I will tell you, if God will change a person like me, can also change a person like you. So the best thing that you can do first and foremost, surrender your life to Jesus. Be like Bartimaeus. Tell Jesus, I want to see. And he'll help you to see what. When I say to see, I mean you can be physically, or rather your physical eyes might be seen, but your insight, your spirit man can see what you become. Last, God has an agenda with everyone's life. He preserved you in your mother's womb. He have kept your life that long. I don't know how long have you lived on this earth, but I want to encourage someone and tell them, Jesus has an agenda with your life. May God bless you.
Amen. Amen. I don't know if I could add anything. You have said the most. We are very grateful that you are able to join us up to the end of the show. And we are hoping to catch you next week, Saturday at 9:45 p.m. This is The Conquerors Show on Wema TV, the voice of hope. Goodbye.